Hi guys, Brian from Brian Boas here. There are a lot of laws that apply to keeping and breeding boa constrictors, and depending on where you live, keeping a boa might actually be illegal. Today I'm going to discuss some of the generalities of these laws that apply to boas. If you're new to the channel, this is the place for information on all aspects of keeping and breeding boa constrictors in captivity. So if you want to learn all about these beautiful animals, be sure to subscribe so you don't miss out on any of my future boa videos. First off, I have to give a couple disclaimers for this video. The first is I'm not a lawyer. This isn't intended to be legal advice. This is just intended to be a general discussion of the laws that apply to boa constrictors. So be sure you understand all of the applicable laws that apply to your given situation. The second disclaimer is please follow all of the applicable laws. I know a lot of the laws make zero sense and they're really dumb, but unfortunately they're laws and they will be enforced. And what ends up happening is anytime somebody violates a law regarding boa constrictors and they get busted, these types of stories tend to end up on the 6 o'clock news. They give a very sensationalized, one-sided version, and it gives fuel to those groups out there that want to try to ban boas. And these types of stories have a really bad impact on everybody that keeps boas, even those that follow all the laws. So please follow all of the applicable laws that apply to you. So why do we have laws that affect ownership of boa constrictors? Well, the first and probably the foremost reason in the public eye is to protect people from the dangers of being attacked by one of these animals. In addition, there are laws that are in existence to protect the environment in case there is a boa or other species which escapes and becomes established as an invasive species, as well as to protect boas and other endangered species and their natural habitat. Interpretation of the laws that apply to boa constrictors are often not at all straightforward. In addition, there's often a lot of misinformation out there and conflicting information, and I was often really confused in my research for this video when I tried to get a more comprehensive understanding of the laws. When we think about the laws, they apply at multiple levels. So we have local laws that affect cities or counties, we have laws that affect states, and then we have federal laws for those of us living in the United States. And then we also have international laws as well as the laws specific to other countries if you're living in a country outside of the United States. And then lest we forget, sometimes people live in housing communities that have local rules regarding ownership of these animals. So there's this multiple levels that you have to try to sift through to understand whether something is legal or not. And often the law can be somewhat gray and open to interpretation. So as I mentioned, one of the main reasons for these restrictions is due to the public perception that boa constrictors and large snakes are dangerous and pose a threat to human life. But is this actually the case? Well, I did a lot of research trying to find documented cases of people who have been killed by boa constrictors. And the only case I could find was there was a man in Nebraska in 2010 who supposedly was killed by a 9-foot, 25-pound, it said red-tail boa, but I couldn't find any specific details. If any of you guys out there have any details on this or other cases, please let me know. There are, of course, every few years we hear about someone that's killed by a constrictor, typically a Burmese python or reticulated python. I think there was a case with an African rock python a few years ago. So this does happen every few years that someone is unfortunate enough to be killed by a large constrictor. However, when you look at the actual statistics of fatalities, and this is from a paper by Forrester et al. 2017, the paper is entitled An Update on Fatalities Due to Venomous and Non-Venomous Animals in the United States from 2008 to 2015 in the journal Wilderness and Environmental Medicine, and I'll put the link in the description below the video if you want to check out that paper. But in that period of from 2008 to 2015, there was a total of 2 fatalities related to a non-venomous reptile. One of them was due to an alligator or crocodilian, and then the other one was due to in the other non-venomous reptile category, which probably was a large constrictor. In comparison, There are typically, every year in the United States, there are about 30 deaths due to dog attacks. There's about 20 fatalities due to horse-related accidents or interactions. And then about 20 to 30 fatalities due to other farm animals like cows and pigs. So you're much, much more likely statistically to be killed by a farm animal than you are by your pet constrictor. And as far as I can tell, your odds of being killed by a boa constrictor are pretty much infinitesimal. So somebody, if you have any more statistics, again, I'd love to hear about any documented cases of deaths due to boa constrictors. And then, lest we not forget that the most deadly species to humans is, of course, other humans. Every year in the United States, there's approximately 10,000 non-negligent homicides, intentional homicides, murders, etc., where one human kills another. However, there's still a general perception among the public that boa constrictors and other large snakes are dangerous to human life, and this has led to an outright ban in many areas. For example, New York City and San Francisco are two cities where all boas and pythons are banned. So you can do a lot of crazy stuff in San Francisco that to me seems very dangerous, but you know, you can't keep a pet boa or even a ball python for that matter. Some other areas have restrictions on the size of the snake that you can keep. A lot of areas that have these laws, you can't keep any snake that's over 8 feet long. And this presents somewhat of a quandary with boa constrictors. As I've mentioned many times before, people grossly over-exaggerate the size of these animals, and the vast majority of boas that I've kept and interacted with have been well under 8 feet in length. This is an adult male crawl key boa who's about 4 feet long and isn't really going to get any bigger than this. However, the literature in general indicates that boas have a maximum size of roughly 12 to 13 feet. And then there's this often quoted, grossly incorrect statistic that they get up, one boa got up to 18 feet, which was almost certainly an anaconda and not a boa constrictor. However, I think a lot of the people are going to interpret these laws that any boa constrictor, because these animals can hypothetically get over 8 feet, even a snake like this would be banned in those areas. But that's where these laws kind of hit the gray area, and it's really open to interpretation. But just be sure that you understand all of the applicable laws that apply to where you live and that you follow them. There are laws that apply by the state, and every state has its own set of laws about what species are legal or illegal. For example, Massachusetts, it's legal to keep boa constrictors, but apparently illegal to keep anacondas and reticulated pythons. In Hawaii, it's illegal to keep any snake because they're concerned that the snakes might escape and become an invasive species. But every state is a little bit different. So you have to understand the state law as well as the local laws that apply to you. And then we have the federal laws, which apply to the whole United States. Before discussing some of the federal laws, I wanted to discuss one level above that, the international laws. And there is a law that's called CITES, or the Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species. And what CITES is an international agreement that governs the sale and export of endangered species, or you know, parts of endangered species, both plants and animals. And basically, there are two levels of protection. There's the Appendix 1 and the Appendix 2 classifications. So the Appendix 1 classification is a complete ban on any export of that particular species. The Appendix 2 classification allows some export of that species given that the proper permits are obtained. And the Appendix 1 animals are judged to be in immediate danger of extinction, whereas the Appendix 2 animals are judged to be vulnerable and, you know, possibly subject to extinction in the future, although currently not in immediate danger of extinction. And so how it applies to boas is that there's one species that's an Appendix 1 species, or one type of boa, and that is the Argentine boa, like this one. And so the Argentine boa, Boa constrictor occidentalis, is the only Appendix 1 listed animal as far as boas on CITES, as far as boa constrictors, I should say, not the broader classification of the whole boa family. All of the other boa constrictor types are classified as an Appendix 2 animal, and export can be allowed given the proper permits are obtained. And so, getting back to the Argentine boas, they were listed on CITES as Appendix 1 back in the late 80s, and there were several groups of animals that were exported before they were listed. And luckily, the captive breeding population in the United States was established by these animals that were exported before they were listed, and these are the animals that we have to work with today in captivity in the U.S. And it's pretty much impossible that we'll have any more animals that are going to be exported from Argentina or, you know, any of their range in South America in the foreseeable future due to the CITES listing. And I definitely applaud protection of these animals in the wild and protection of pretty much any endangered species. But from what I hear, there's actually quite a few far more vulnerable types of boas in the wild than Argentine boas. And just completely banning the export might not be the best way to protect the animals in the wild. So getting back to the CITES, all of the other types of boas are CITES II, and they can be exported given the proper paperwork. So this is an example. This is a CITES document that accompanied a shipment of boas out of Iquitos, Peru. And basically it just says the number of animals, the country that they came from, and the species. And so in order for any boa constrictor to be exported from its country of where it lives, it requires one of these permits. And they only issue a certain number of permits, and then the countries have to be open to exportation. And a lot of the countries where boa constrictors have their natural range are currently closed to all exportation. So although it's illegal to export an Argentine boa out of the country, it is not illegal to transport it across state lines. And that's where people get confused, because there's something, we get back to the federal laws, there's something called the Lacey Act and the United States Endangered Species Act, and these regulate transport of protected species across state lines. And so the Argentine boa isn't listed on the U.S. endangered species list. Some other reptile species like the eastern indigo snake and the radiated tortoise, they are listed. So if you want to keep either of these species, you need to apply for a permit in order to take it across state lines. And I've never looked into getting a permit until this video. I haven't really been interested in keeping these species, but apparently it used to be relatively easy to get one of these captive bred wildlife permits from the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. But in the last few years, they really cracked down, and now it's almost impossible for a private individual to get one of these permits. And I'll put a link to the permit process if you want to check it out. But looking it over, it looks like the types of questions being asked, that it would be pretty much impossible unless you had previous experience breeding the species in order to get, you know, a permit to keep more of these animals. So for somebody who's a hobbyist that hasn't kept them before, it'd be pretty much impossible. So the Endangered Species Act, which came out in 1973, was a really comprehensive act to protect endangered species. But before this, there was something called the Lacey Act, which came out in 1900. And the Lacey Act was basically enacted to prohibit the trade in illegal wildlife. So originally, it was mostly for wildlife which had been poached, you know, hunted illegally, like game birds, you know, things that people eat. And in 1960, there was an amendment to this act which prohibited transport of the listed species between the continental United States and Hawaii, as well as any possession of the United States. And the 1960 amendment was originally enacted to protect Hawaii from invasive wildlife. They didn't want people to export species from the continental United States to Hawaii that might become invasives. However, in the 1980s, the Fish and Wildlife Service interpreted this as to mean between the continental United States. So you can't bring listed species from Texas to Louisiana or California to Nevada. And I bring this up because the Lacey Act was the basis for a huge event that happened in reptile keeping back in 2012. In 2012, the Fish and Wildlife Service managed to add 4 species of large constricting snake to the Lacey Act. And this was the Burmese python, the yellow anaconda, and the northern and southern African rock pythons. And then in 2015, they managed to add another 4 species, which were the reticulated python, the green anaconda, and then 2 other species of anacondas. They tried to add boa constrictors to the list, but ultimately they didn't do this. And I think it was because they feared that there'd be way too much pushback, since there's, you know, like probably over 1 million boa constrictors in captivity in the United States. And of course, there were a lot of special interest groups, animal rights activists, that were pushing for this law. The primary incentive for adding these species was there's a situation in the Florida Everglades, which most of us have heard about, where there is a large population of invasive Burmese pythons. And this affects the southern part of Florida. These animals would be not able to establish a viable population in any other parts of the United States due to the climate and the lack of resources. However, they were able to argue that the situation in the Everglades justified adding these animals to the Lacey Act and thus effectively banning the transport of any of them across state lines. So, of course, this is an environmental issue that should be dealt with. We don't want invasive animals in the Everglades, but it's really a local issue, and it doesn't make sense to penalize the rest of the country with this, you know, overreach of power. So the act did not, or adding these animals to the Lacey Act, it didn't ban ownership or breeding of them, but it banned transport across state lines. So it effectively banned the trade in these species, because who's going to breed Burmese pythons if you live in, say, Texas and you can't sell them in Louisiana? It's really going to limit your ability to find homes for them, and it's not really going to be worth breeding these species. And it really has the exact opposite effect, because a lot of people ended up just releasing their animals when they couldn't breed them anymore, because it didn't make sense for them to have them anymore. Not surprisingly, there was a huge amount of pushback against this new legislation. As you can imagine, people who were unfortunate enough to be working with these affected species potentially were going to lose everything they had worked so hard for. So the United States Association of Reptile Keepers, or USARC, filed a lawsuit against the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service to try to overturn this new provision of the Lacey Act. And so rather than go after the flawed logic and science behind adding these new species, they simply went after the wording of the amendment to the Lacey Act, which forbids transport across state lines. And if you read the wording, I just want to make sure I get this correct. It says it bans shipments between the continental United States, comma, Hawaii, comma, or other districts, possessions, and territories. So the Fish and Wildlife Service interpreted this as to mean that it banned shipments between the individual continental United States. You can't take it from California to Nevada. But the original intent was to ban shipments between the entire continental United States and Hawaii, the other districts, possessions, and territories, because they wanted to keep invasive mongooses or monkeys out of Hawaii. And so the judge agreed with the interpretation that this does not ban transport between the individual continental United States, and thus the ban on shipping these species across state lines was overturned. And what's kind of interesting is that many of these species were relatively inexpensive before the ban was in place, like the green anacondas. And after the ban was lifted, the prices had skyrocketed. So hopefully the people who work with these species had kept with it, and ultimately they prevailed in the end. So it's great that this was overturned. However, there are groups out there that want to do whatever they can to ban ownership of reptiles. So we need to continue to fight this type of legislation. So I highly recommend supporting USARC and other groups that fight for the rights that we have to keep these amazing animals. I hope this video was helpful. As you probably noticed, there's a lot that I left out that I couldn't comment on. So if you have any additional input on any of these legal issues regarding boas, I really would appreciate if you can bring them up in the comments. Thanks for watching. If you have any questions or comments, feel free to reach out to me, and enjoy your boas.